Welcome to this talk entitled Considerations for Children with Hearing Loss and Complex Needs, Aural Rehabilitation and Telehealth Delivery. Let's look at a working definition for aural rehabilitation. It encompasses all of the different professionals involved in assisting the child in learning to communicate. This can be medicine, audiology, speech pathology, education, special education, occupational therapy, physical therapy, and other professionals that are needed for the child's optimum development. What goes into all of these services? We have to assess the child's abilities and limitations and use these findings to select an appropriate means of communication for each child. We need to provide therapy services to teach the child and caregivers to communicate with each other so they can express their wants, needs, and ideas. We need to educate and coach the parents and the caregivers and communication partners to engage in effective two-way communication with the child. We need to build a team of professionals to manage each child's needs and be the team manager. What are the overarching goals of our rehab? We want to optimize receptive and expressive communication between the person with hearing loss and their communication partners, which may include the family, the team, the friends, teachers and students, and eventually coworkers and employers. We want to optimize communication and linguistic ability for the child to lead as full a life as possible for socialization, education, employment, and leisure. Let's look at some examples of etiologies with hearing loss with comorbid conditions that affect communication. One of them is bacterial meningitis. It can affect hearing, cognitive abilities, neuromotor skills, vision, and other sensory and sensory motor integrative functions. Charge association can affect hearing, cognitive abilities, vision, sensory and sensory motor processing, oral motor skills, psychosocial function, and others. Unknown etiologies can leave a child with hearing loss and autism. Cleft lip and palate can cause structural anomalies of the mouth and dentition and impair neuromuscular function of the speech mechanism. Deaf blindness affects hearing and vision and can cause sensory processing and sensory differences and impair cognitive function. Other genetic disorders may result in any number or combination of disorders. What do we need to know about cognitive reorganization? What is it, and how might it affect management of a child with hearing loss? When a child has hearing loss in infancy, their brain has auditory deprivation. And in some children, this has significant impact on their brain development and causes changes in their brain. It can cause cognitive, psychosocial, sensory processing and sensory integration differences, and language impairment. What are some other factors that guide our approach to aural rehab for individual children? We have to look at the structure of the auditory system and how it affects our selection of hearing technologies, the quality of sound the child receives, and how it impacts the communication mode we might select. If a child has a malformed outer ear or ear canal, what type of hearing aid can be considered? What are your options? Will the child need bone conduction hearing aid, or might they need to undergo surgery for correction of the structures? What is the status of the eardrum, middle ear, and the ossicles? Is medical intervention needed to improve hearing and/or accommodate a hearing aid? What's the status of the inner ear, the cochlea? Are there cochlear abnormalities, such as a partial cochlea, or a common cavity with an absent cochlea? What's the status of the auditory nerve? Is it present? Is it absent? Does it appear that there's sufficient cochlear nerve to transmit the cochlear implant signal to the brain? Or might an auditory brainstem be the only option to provide the child some access to sound? What is the availability of hearing technology for that child, and how does that affect what communication mode you might select? Let's look at hearing aids. If the child has some usable residual hearing, are cost and availability factors in hearing aid selection? Can the child have one or two hearing aids? Regarding cochlear implants, are cost and availability factors? How will the equipment and program be maintained over the lifespan of the child? If the child has an auditory brainstem implant, in the event of an absent cochlear, absent cochlea or cochlear nerve deficiency? Are cost and what are the cost and availability factors involved? Are there professionals who know the special AR needs of a child with an auditory brainstem implant? Children who have associated disorders that affect communication require individualized team of specialists. Who might be on that team? You might need a surgeon for craniofacial anomalies, ear malformations, cochlear implantation, or ABI surgery. You might need a listening and spoken language specialist if the child has some hearing you're going to use for their communication. You'll need a teacher who can communicate in the local forms of sign language if that is selected. You'll need a speech pathologist who understands apraxia, dysarthria, cleft palate, auditory processing disorders, language disorders, and a specialist in augmentative systems for certain children. Who else might be on the team? An occupational therapist for children with poor vestibular vision and tactile processing, a mobility specialist, a nurse if a child has chronic health issues, and other team members depending on the needs of the child. What modes of communication are available to children with hearing loss and other disorders that affect their communication? There are verbal approaches, such as listening and spoken language, speech reading, which is using the hearing technology in addition to visual cues, and cued speech, which is spoken language accompanied by a system of hand shapes that reflects the phonetic characteristics of phonemes. There are visual approaches, such as sign language and gestures, eye gaze, a combination of signs, gestures, and speech reading and lip reading, and alternative communication systems, and whatever other visual approach you might individually design for a child. There are tactile kinesthetic approaches, such as the Tadoma method, where you place the child's hand on your face so they can feel jaw movement, feel the airstream and vibration. There's tactile sign and tactile finger spelling, where you sign in the child's hand or finger spell in their hand, and other tactile kinesthetic approaches you might invent for a child. Some children with multiple needs need more than one communication mode. For example, Charlie has charge association. He has bilateral profound sensory neural hearing loss from birth. At age two, he received two cochlear implants and has good access to sound. Charlie has a repaired severe cleft and palate with severe dentition issues and severe oral motor issues. At age nine, he uses listening and auditory comprehension for receptive language, and he uses sign and semi-intelligible speech for expressive language. Let's look at Amanda, who has deaf blindness. Amanda was blind at birth and had a progressive hearing loss, and she had bilateral profound sensory neural hearing loss by age five. Her mother started using tactile sign at that time and used it for the next 6 years. At age 11, Amanda received a unilateral cochlear implant and worked with an auditory verbal therapist who paired tactile sign with listening to redevelop Amanda's listening and spoken language skills. The AVT used tactile fingerspelling and the Tadoma method to improve Amanda's articulation. At age 30, Amanda communicates in several ways. She uses spoken language in conjunction with signs for expressive language. She uses tactile sign and tactile fingerspelling for receptive language. And she also uses the hearing with her cochlear implant partially for receptive language. What type of assessment do we need to do when selecting an appropriate mode of communication? We need to assess the function of each area of the child that is needed for receptive and expressive communication in a particular approach. These might include cognition, hearing, vision, sensory motor, and tactile functions. What functions are needed for various modes of communication? Well, a child's nonverbal cognitive status is the foundation of symbolic communication. Is the child capable of using symbols and for learning the syntactic rules of a language? Is vision required? It certainly is required for speech reading, sign language, use of eye gaze, gestures, and most augmentative systems. Tactile processing of the hand is needed for tactile sign and finger spelling. And tactile processing is needed for the Tadoma method and other forms of stimulation of the face during articulation therapy. Will a child's oral motor disorders such as dyspraxia or dysarthria interfere with verbal expression? Does a child have sufficient manual dexterity to use sign language? And do they have sensory motor skills needed for an augmentative or alternative system? What else do we need to assess when selecting an appropriate mode of communication? Number one, we have to look at the professionals in the area. Is there somebody that has the expertise in the mode that's selected for a child? Are the caregivers likely to learn the communication mode that is recommended? Some parents don't learn to use sign language beyond a preschool level. Others may not feel comfortable with an AAC system. And methods such as cued speech and Tadoma take a lot of specialized instruction. We also have to ask, is there an educational system that will be using the recommended communication mode for instruction and socialization? Let's take a look at the role of the primary caregiver in communication development in hearing impaired children. The caregiver is the key communication partner with the child who has hearing loss, whether or not there's comorbid conditions. The caregiver is the primary person who interacts with the child throughout the day. The role of the AR practitioner is to observe the caregiver in a natural interactions with the child and coach them to foster communication throughout the routines of the child's day. The practitioner and caregiver work together, so the caregiver becomes competent in communicating with a child throughout daily routines. The caregiver and the professional form a trusting relationship with each other and come to agreement on communication goals for the child. The practitioner advises the caregivers on a wide variety of subject matters, such as communication, socialization, and education. What is the role of the caregiver in facilitating communication in a child with complex needs? With the assistance of the AR specialist, the caregiver often becomes the coordinator amongst all of the professionals on the child's team. They make themselves available to meet with and be instructed by each team member. They communicate with all of the professionals to update each one on the child's progress or status. And they carry out the home program set up by each of the professionals. What are some of the educational considerations for children with hearing loss and comorbid conditions? We have to ask what type of school setting is best for the child. Might it be homeschooling, a private school for children with specific needs, the public school? And for each of these, at what age might the child begin these programs? We need to foster a positive relationship with the principal and administrator, and we need to develop a positive and cooperative relationship with the teacher and the aides. What type of curriculum is best for each child's communication skills, sensory, motor, and cognitive abilities? A type of curriculum needed may change as the child's life unfolds. They may need one type of curriculum at one point in their life and a different type at another. A child may need a program that is based on language, play, and social interaction. An older child might need some life skill training. Some children may qualify for vocational training, and others may succeed in an academic program. How does all of this fit into a teletherapy delivery model? We have to look at the availability of the technology of the caregiver and the provider, what platforms are available to both parties, what is the stability of connectivity for both parties, and is time of day and time zone differences going to interfere? Who will participate in the sessions? The caregiver, extended family members, other members of the team? Will translators be needed? And who will disperse the information discussed to the rest of the team? Will the child engage with the practitioner, or will the practitioner coach the caregiver to interact with the child? Will team members set up co-treatment telesessions to demonstrate strategies and discuss goals? And what therapy materials can be used that are readily available at home, easily purchased or prepared? Helping children with hearing loss and complex needs can be very challenging. I've had varying degrees of success in using teletherapy with this population. With patience, perseverance, and everyone working together, many children can progress over time and learn to communicate with family, friends, and teachers. I want to thank you very much for this opportunity to share my experiences with you.